I give thanks and praises to the Almighty Creator, who is known as Ra in the language of the Kimishans. That's what some people call Egyptians. Onyami in the language of the Akan people, that's tree. And the Akan people are, of course, the Fanti and the Ashanti, the Bron and others. Ama in the language of the Dogon. Chuku in the language of the Igbo, and Igbo is spelled I-G-B-O. Olurun Oludumare in the language of the Yoruba. Mwari in the language of the Shona, of which President Mugabe is a member of the Shona people. Maulisa in the language of the Fu, spelled F-O-N, but pronounced Fu. This is a place that used to be known as Dahomey, but is now known as Benin. Maulisa, literally meaning mother, father, showing that we as Africans, our ancestors knew that the Creator had attributes that were both male and female. For there to be life, there had to be the male and female input combination. And so Maulisa, in the language of the Fu, whose religion, spirituality, is commonly known as Voodoo, Maulisa, mother, father. I give thanks and praises today, Sunday, the 16th of October, 2016. And Sunday, again, why Sunday? Sunday came about because of our African tradition. Amen Ra, the sun creator, the creator of the sun, life, everything. So Sunday literally means the day of the creator. That's where it is coming from. A lot of people hear the word, but they don't realize that it is actually coming from our African tradition, from Kemet, meaning the land of the dark black-skinned people, which has been misnamed Egypt, because Egypt really is the spiritual name for the capital, for the creator. Another name for the creator in commission religion and spirituality is Ptah, P-T-A-H. And it literally means, coming from Ikupta, meaning mansion of the soul of Ptah. And this is how the word Egyptian came about. But the Greeks coming on the scene and hearing our people using the expression thought that this spiritual name for the capital of what is called Memphis of the Menes, but of course the original name is Narma, did not realize that it did not refer to the country, it was just the spiritual name for the capital. The title of my talk today is The Role of Education in African History Month. And before I embark on that, I want to let it be understood or overstood that every month is African History Month. Every day is African History Day. Every night is African History Night. So when we use what is called October, it is merely a time to galvanize our people, to bring in those of our people who are unconscious about what they need to know in terms of knowing themselves, and also to reinforce those who know about the tradition that we must educate ourselves, which is very, very important. I have been an Africanist, meaning one who preaches and practices the ideology, the philosophy of the world's greatest African leader ever, Marcus Garvey, since my school days at Kingston Technical High School, 82 Hanover Street, Kingston, Jamaica, in 1968. At Kingston Technical High School, my physics teacher was the first son of Marcus Garvey, Marcus Garvey Jr. And he and I and others founded in 1968 a political party in Jamaica known as the African Nationalist Union, ANU. So before I came to this country to study civil engineering after graduating from Kingston Technical High School, I already knew that I was an African from Jamaica. I didn't have to come to this country because a lot of us know that a lot of our people have left the Caribbean. They only came to realize that they were African or so-called black when they came to Britain or when they went to Canada and when they went to the States, the United States, and when they faced the open racism of Europeans. That was how a lot of people started to realize the importance of their race and what it meant. But before I came to this country, I was fully aware and practiced the fact that I was an African and that what Marcus Garvey and others before him had done, both males and females, that I and others should continue this work, because the work that we have to do is a work that must be done generation after generation. There is no stopping to it. Our enemies never stop working to keep us down in all manners of enslavement. And likewise, if we are to be free and to be progressive, we have to work even harder, constantly. There is never a break from this. Now, education. Education, which is an English word, is coming from a Latin word, educare. The first part, the X coming from to lead, care, to lead out. So education is something that everyone has, that potential, but you need it to be cultivated, harnessed, and you need a teacher and teachers to bring out your full potential. So it's something within, as Marcus Garvey said. One of my Bibles, yes, Bibles, because whenever Christians talk about Bible, they forget that the first Bibles were from Africa, our motherland. And the word, that's where the word is coming from. And it literally means book, because we, our ancestors, made the first books. So, for Christians, they have their Bible, Old Testament and New Testament. I, as an African, I have my Bibles. This is my first Bible, the philosophy and opinions of Marcus Garvey. Another Bible that I have is the School of African Philosophy, 22 private lessons that Marcus Garvey gave to his trusted and younger members of his movement in Canada in 1937. And this was published by my brother from Trinidad, Brother Tony Martin, who is now an ancestor. 22 private lessons. And they were given to him by a man who was later to become the President General of the UNI and ACL, Honorable Charles L. James, who was from Antigua, and a man who I had the pleasure of meeting in the 1980s when he came to this country. Another Bible that I always have, and I always read my Bibles, is Race First by Brother Tony Martin, which is the official book of the UNI and ACL, which explains what Marcus Garvey was about and his organization. Race First, the ideological and organizational struggles of Marcus Garvey and the UNIA and ACL. And let us remember that the Negro word that is used in English is the Spanish word meaning black. So, or in Portuguese, same thing, black. I did Spanish at secondary school in Jamaica. So I know that when I see the word Negro, it literally refers to the color black. Marcus Garvey, when he first left Jamaica, he went to places like Panama, Colombia, Ecuador, Costa Rica, etc. And he spoke, Marcus Garvey also spoke Spanish. His first wife is my mother's mother's cousin, Amy Ashwood Garvey, and she was a founder member of the organization. His second wife, who had two sons for him, Amy, Jakes Garvey, was someone who I knew personally also. So I was well schooled from Jamaica in the story of Marcus Garvey and the UNI and ACL, of which I was a member like his son, and I've told you about the political party that we formed, and we had a newspaper called The Black Man, which continued the Black Man paper that his father, many years before, published for. The month of February is when they celebrate what is called African History Month. I don't use the term Black History Month, I say African History Month. And the reason why I say that, there are a lot of people who will tell you that they are black, but that they are not African. They still have that slave mentality, which they were indoctrinated in, that they are ashamed to identify themselves as being African. I'm always proud of declaring myself to be an African. And I'm sure all of you here know the Peter Tosh song, African. Am I right? No matter where you're born, no matter where you come from, as long as, you know, we have the physical features, you're an African. Because this is very, very important. But Carter Goodwin Woodson, he was born on the 19th of December, 1875, in New Canton, Virginia, and became an ancestor on the 3rd of April, 1950. His most popular book, and this is a book that if you have not read it, you must read it, is called The Miseducation of the Negro, meaning the miseducation of the black. Now, he launched a history week, an Our Story Week, in the second week of February, 1926. That's 10 years after Marcus Garvey arrived in New York City. But before, on the 9th of September, 1915, he and four others started an association for the study of our African story. And Carter Goodwin Woodson is the second African to receive a doctorate, a PhD, from Harvard University. The first one was a jealous enemy of Marcus Garvey, W.E.B. Du Bois, of the National Association of Colored People. And it was Du Bois who used the word colored because he didn't like to use the word black. Deliberately, he was the one who said, you know, say colored, not black, not Negro. Too black for him. He was the first to get a PhD from Harvard. But what is important is that this man, Carter Goodwin Woodson, he was given a platform many times to speak at UNIA and ACL meetings in New York City and elsewhere by Marcus Garvey, the first president general of the UNIA and ACL. So, you see the influence of Marcus Garvey, who gave this man the platform to be teaching African history at UNIA and ACL meetings. Marcus Garvey, in this book, The Philosophy and Opinions of Marcus Garvey, said, and this is important, education is the medium by which a people are prepared for the creation of their own particular civilization and the advancement and glory of their own race. This is very important. I repeat, Marcus Garvey, in The Philosophy and Opinions of Marcus Garvey, said, education is the medium by which a people are prepared for the creation of their own particular civilization and the advancement and glory of their own race. Marcus Garvey Jr. summarized the black print solution that his father gave for the African race in 8 steps, 8 years of life. And I will go through them briefly, succinctly. And afterwards we can have some reasonings. What is important is that every organization relies on the quality of the individual members. The better the individual members are in terms of their contributions, the stronger will be the organization. And one finds that in every organization, it is always the few hardworking ones who make that essential working relationship to sustain that organization. You have noticed that a lot of times you have some organizations that are doing well, flourishing. There are a lot of members. And then all of a sudden, it dies, it goes down. And when you examine, you found that some of the key people the key movers who were always working either passed on and they were not replaced by people with of similar caliber, or they had left for whatever reasons. So I am saying this to show that a lot of times when I talk to my African people and say, you are important as an individual. And I say this to them because a lot of times, do you know what they say to me? We have these problems, but what can I do? I'm just one person. And I have to tell them, it is essential what you as one person does. Because if you have the attitude that there's nothing that you as one individual can do, and everyone goes away with that idea, then we will get nowhere. It starts with you. Don't look at what others are doing. You must see about what you can do to benefit not just yourself, but your own African race. This is very, very important. You have to have that belief in yourself that you can make a difference, that the contribution that you make is important. Because the saying that a chain is as strong as its weakest link, it is true. Because what are the links? Individuals. What is an organization? An organization is an amalgamation of individuals. A building, I am a civil engineer, I am also a journalist. But as a civil engineer, when I construct, say, a house, a building, there are the building blocks. The building blocks are individuals, are they not? But what makes them strong is the putting together of the individual blocks in a systematic, in a scientific way. So what is important is the strength of the individual blocks being put together. The point that I'm stressing is that every individual is important, because we have had individuals have traitors who have committed individual acts of betrayal that have set back our race. And likewise, we have individuals who have done positive things, who have advanced our race. So it is important what each individual does, because every action that you do is never neutral. And this was how Marcus Garvey was. He was a utilitarian. Was it of benefit to the African race? Or was it something to retard our progress? Every action that you take must be examined in this light. Every action, no exception. The first of the eight areas and steps that Marcus Garvey Jr. summarized for his father's black print solution, because Marcus Garvey, as the greatest African leader ever, as the architect, gave us the black print solution. What we must do is that we must work to implement the black print that Marcus Garvey gave us. There is no excuse for any African, any part of the world, whether it is in this country or any country in Mother Africa, in the Caribbean, anywhere, to say that they do not know what to do. Marcus Garvey gave us the black print solution in the philosophy and opinions of Marcus Garvey, in his works. Marcus Garvey not only founded but led the largest African organization in history, had a paper that was published in three languages, English, French, and Spanish. In Mother Africa, if the European colonialists found you with a copy of the paper, the African world, the so-called Negro world, you would be imprisoned or you would be shot because it was considered seditious. Because the information, the education that it contained was a threat to their racist rule over our people. Over the years as a journalist, I have written for a lot of papers. I'm on radio stations, etc., and so on every week. I'm on Conscious Radio. I'm on IrieFM every week speaking with a person who he and I went to Kingston Technical High School together. That's Muta Baruka. He was 1 year below me at school. But recently, I came out with this paper called Reggae World. Now, some years ago, I had a paper called Mandingo News and Views. And these are some of the editions. The one here, with the red, I did a tribute. This was in 2004 for the Haitian Revolution, because on the 1st of January, 1804, Dessalines, who led the Africans of Haiti to victory, declared Haiti to be an independent republic. And so I wrote a story about that in this edition. And let us remember that the leader who started the Haitian Revolution was an African voodoo priest from Jamaica by the name of Bookman. Bookman because he could read. So in Jamaica it was spelled Book, B-O-O-K-M-A-N, but in Haiti, B-O-U-K-M-A-N. He was the leader. And before the rebellion started, the night, they had in the forest a voodoo religious ceremony where they said, throw away the images of the Europeans, you know, the blonde, blue-eyed Jesus Christ, and embrace our Creator. And this inspired our people. So when you hear Europeans trying to put down voodoo as they always do, it is because they know that this was what inspired our people in Haiti to rise up and to defeat first the French and later on the Spanish as well as the English in Haiti. The first thing is identity. And for those of you who are here, this Reggae World, I came up with this in August. It's an August-September edition. And it's dedicated to Marcus Garvey. And each of you can have a copy, but there's a fee because it's a color one, because it's self-produced, self-reliance. I had to pay the money to do the printing and everything. So if you want a copy, because they explain all 8 steps and things about Marcus Garvey and his organization, you can give me a minimum donation of £1. If you want to give me more than £1, that's fine. But a minimum donation of £1 afterwards. But the first step is identity. All varying shades of darkness, blackness, variations of woolly hair, and irrespective of places of birth and citizenship, we are Africans. And I quoted the reggae song by Peter Tosh of the Wailing Wailers group that describes the fact that we are Africans. We are not any black and minority ethnic people. We are not any Afro-British and African-American. All of these other words have been used to try to divorce us from our identity that we are Africans. Why do I Mandingo as a Garveyite, meaning an Africanist, the same thing? stress this, the word African. If we are to move together, we must have a name in common. Once you are having different names for the same people, that in itself is a recipe for division and to perpetuate division. It must be one name. Because if you get caught in a situation that some are calling themselves colored, some are calling themselves West Indian, some are calling themselves Afro-American, some are calling themselves black minority ethnic, some are calling themselves Negro, etc. There is no room for us to move together as one. There must be one name, and that name is African. And let me explain this, because this is something that the Nation of Islam have misinformed people about. The word Africa is not a Roman name. The Romans spoke Latin. Let me explain. Scipio Africanus. Africanus in Latin, and I did Latin at school in Jamaica. I went to a Roman Catholic school, a Jesuit school. I did Spanish and I did Latin. And almost all of these people talking about these words and so, never even did Latin. Scipio was the name of the Roman general. Now, it is a feature that when the Romans had this trend, that if their generals conquered a certain territory or a certain place, they gave them the title of the place, the title. So his name was Scipio. Do your research and you'll see what his name was, that it was Scipio. When he defeated the Carthaginians, that area of Northwest Africa was known as Africa. It's an indigenous word, an African word, meaning a tropical place, and so on. Because of his victory, that part of the continent that was known as Africa, he was given the title Africanus because they had conquered there. Speed forward many hundreds of years later, you remember that Field Marshal Montgomery, who was from Lambeth in South London. You remember he defeated the Germans at El Alamein. For those of you who know your history, he defeated them in their European World War. European World War. His name was Montgomery. But in recognition of his victory, following the Romans, he was given the title Viscount El Alamein. It's the same thing. You remember the Ethiopian Emperor Tewodros, who shot himself, killed himself, rather than be captured by the British, and his son was taken away and brought to this country. The British general who led the British invasion force, the officers were British, the troops were Indian, sepoys. His name was Napier. Go to Trafalgar Square and you will see Napier. One of those statues, you see the job, that's the same one. He's the one who defeated Emperor Tewodros of Abyssinia, Ethiopia. He was given the title Mandingo because that was a place where he won. And the only reason why he won is that other Africans in Ethiopia did not come to the support of Emperor Tirodras, including the one who later on was to be known as Menelik II. So much so that when it was his time to fight the Italians who had invaded on this and that decisive battle on the 2nd of March 1896 at Adwa, that he remembered that he and other Ethiopians did not come to the help of Emperor Tirodras, didn't form a common front and say, yes, we have our differences, but these are Europeans, let's come together. Because if they had done that, Emperor Tirodras would not have been defeated. Would not have been defeated. He begged them to say, learn from what had happened with what he and others had done in not helping Emperor Tirodras and making the British win. Don't let that happen. And they came together, and this was why we were victorious at Adwa. So I've given you some examples to show that the name that we have as African is a native indigenous name. It's not a Latin name. They got it from us, and it was given to Scipio in recognition of his defeat of the Carthaginians, defeating Hannibal at the Battle of, I think, Zama. So be proud to say that you are African, and don't let anyone get away with saying that they are not African and you shouldn't call yourself African. Because if you do not know yourself, that's a recipe for total disaster. Once we do not have our identity secure, nothing else is secure. So that's the first thing. Always be proud. Hold your question until, don't forget, hold your question until. The second thing is pride. Our African ancestors were the first people on the planet. And not only were they the first people on the planet, they were the first engineers, the first doctors, the first architects, etc. There's no such thing as the Pythagoras theorem. Pythagoras and those other Greeks, they came to North Africa and learned about mathematics from us. If anything, it is a 3-4-5 triangle, not any Pythagoras triangle. We are with the 3-4-5, it's the hypotenuse squared is equal to the opposite squared plus the adjacent squared. So we must be proud, take pride, that we as Africans know that we created the world's first civilization. Civilization means people who live in cities. This is what it literally means. We built the first cities. So we have a lot to be proud of. And as Marcus Garvey said, as our ancestors did in former times, so shall we do even greater works, because we have the ability to do this. Self-reliance. There's a slave mentality that has been put on our people that we must not have African organizations, that we must always have non-Africans to come in our organizations. It is a slave mentality when you believe that you cannot come together and develop and build things for yourselves. It doesn't mean that you do not have relations with non-Africans, because they have relations with us. But you notice, the Chinese, the Indians, Europeans, all of them, Arabs, they have their racial organizations where they do not allow any person who is not a member of their race to come to their events. They have their racial family events. This event is such an event. This place is such a place. We must, at all times, of our own exclusive African gatherings where we discuss and deal with matters concerning us as a race. This was what Marcus Garvey taught us. This was by the UNI and the ACN. It's exclusively African. Malcolm X, whose parents was African, Garveyites, when he formed an organization, shortly before his organization, he was assassinated. He was asked if non-Africans could be allowed into his organization. And read that book. It's a black-covered book about Malcolm X, about our history. And in it he said, no, we have to have our organizations that are exclusively African. He had another organization called Muslim Incorporated thing. He said that's a religious thing for people like him who, you know, dealing with the Muslim thing. But we must have our exclusively African organizations where it has nothing to do with what religious group you belong to. Because as Malcolm X said, we are not catching hell because we are Baptist, Protestant, or whatever. We are catching hell because we are Africans. So we come together as Africans. When we allow others to come into our organizations, we are diluting that strong black coffee that used to keep us up, keep us aware. Diluting it with milk, meaning non-Africans, puts us to sleep, keeps us in slavery. Excellent analogy. Because remember, even within our exclusive African organizations, we have traitors, enemy agents. This is a fact. Marcus Garvey and those before him went through that. We have traitors. Now, we have enough problems to contend with traitors within our own race than to be recruiting and inviting non-Africans to come in further. No, we can't do without the extra work. We have enough work to be able to be monitoring who is who within our African organizations. And we make no apology for having our organizations that must be at all times exclusively African. And you know, some of our people have been miseducated and stupid. Yes, stupid. And this is what leads to enslavement. They will admire other races having their racial meetings, organizations, and so on. And say, oh, the Chinese, the Europeans, oh, you see how they have unity and love and progress. But when you say to these same people, well, let us do the same for ourselves, no, 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 that's racist. Don't want to belong to anything that is just us who are in it. There are some of our people, they do not feel secure if they do not have some non-African in the organization. It's a slave mentality. It's a dependency syndrome. Because what it is saying is that you can't do anything for yourself. You have to depend on a non-African. That's a slave mentality. And that has to be destroyed completely. Four, economic power. We have to learn and practice, as Marcus Garvey said, to trade with each other, buy from each other. We buy from other people, but we must give each other preferences first. In business, we must network with each other. We must communicate with each other. One of the reasons why I have noticed that a lot of organizations, African organizations in the world, some of them fall down, is that they'll start out good, but this thing of non-communication, it's a very serious problem. Too many of our people, not all, the only time that they engage and see each other is at meetings like this. No, we're not gonna be having these kind of meetings all the time. We're gonna be having them several times every year. But it is what you do in between the meetings. We must be communicating with each other. A lot of times you communicate with people, whether by phone, email, whatever, let us deal with that. And they're always giving you excuses. Am I right? They're always giving you excuses as if why they couldn't do this and why they couldn't. You know what I've always said? The easiest thing to manufacture and produce in this world is an excuse. This is how you know people are serious. Judge people, not according to what they say. Judge people by their actions. Because you know people by what they do or what they don't do. A person will tell you they are this or that. Yes, you hear them. But you can really only know and judge people by actions. And if you have tried with a person several times, don't waste your time. Engage with those who are on the same path as you in terms of working seriously, because it's not the numbers that make things successful. It is the quality of the membership. As I am saying, the fifth one is unity. As I am saying, all other races put their interests first and foremost. And this is something that we have to do. The sixth is a government, whereby Marcus Garvey correctly said that for us as Africans to be respected, we have to establish in our African motherland, which is the second largest continent, and the richest continent, which is why Indians, Chinese, Europeans, all other races want our continent. And let us not take our continent for granted. If we do not protect our continent, we will be exterminated. Already in Northern Africa, we see the Arabs who first invaded Kemet. They are still there. They are in Libya. They are in Morocco, Mauritania. And you know that some of our people in Northwest Africa are still in literal slavery in places like Mauritania. This is a fact. The Arabs use their religion to mentally control the minds of our people, just like Europeans use Christianity. Because you cannot be independent if you believe and respect the religions of your enemies. No way. Because if you worship the blonde, blue-eyed Jesus, and if you go into the homes of most of our African people, and be honest, my people, if you go into the homes of most of our people, whether it's Trinidad, Jamaica, Brazil, this country, almost without exception, you notice that there's a picture of a blonde, blue-eyed Jesus Christ in the home. And you don't see, almost without exception, you don't see any pictures of, say, a Queen Nzinga, a Marcus Garvey, a Malcolm X, a Sojourner Truth, a Harriet Tubman. You don't see those pictures. You don't see pictures in African homes of people looking like ourselves. In fact, when you go into such homes, it's an exception. You're pleasantly surprised. So when you're worshipping images that are the images of the very people who are raped, murdered, and enslaved, and still continue to do so, you are securing and guaranteeing enslavement. Which one of you here have heard, because I got it on my phone, some young Cameroonian sisters in Kuwait who were lured today from the Cameroons, promises of good pay, and you know, a lot of material advancement, and found out that when they went to Kuwait, they had to do domestic chores. They were raped, beaten, ill-treated, horrendous. I have it on my on my phone, someone sent it to me. Very, very sad. And this is the type of thing. There was a situation that some sisters from Zimbabwe a few months ago were deceived again to go and work in Kuwait, Qatar, and places like that, and found out when their passports were taken away, they were ill-treated, had to work like slaves, they were sexually assaulted, some of them have been murdered, etc. Now, this should not be the case for us, our people. We are the richest continent. This is why these non-Africans want our continent. And our people have to be going abroad to have a proper standard of living. Africa. Africans in Africa should have the highest standard of living of anyone on planet Earth, because we have the richest resources. But what has happened is that non-African imperialists have been working through the misleaders, not leaders, traitors in Africa, to keep our people enslaved and to steal our resources. And this is why they keep on attacking President Mugabe, who is the bravest African head of state. And this is why the racist sanctions, Zidera, Z-I-D-E-R-A, that George Walker Bush put on President Mugabe, at the request of that racist homosexual supporter, Tony Blair, to bring down the government of President Mugabe, ZANU-PF. This is why they are always making constant attempts to demonize and to destroy the government of Zimbabwe. Because he's the only African head of state in the world who tells Europeans like it is and says that Zimbabwe will not be a colony again. Have any of you read where the present so-called president of Nigeria is upset and angry with his wife because his wife has denounced him, saying that he's not doing what he's supposed to do to help the people? And his remark, check it out, and his remark is that he's angry with his wife, Buhari, says that she belongs in the kitchen. Check that out, yes. Now, this is the kind of African woman that I want more and more of those African to be. She denounced her husband, the president of Nigeria, because she saw that he was not doing things in the interests of our people in Nigeria. And his remark is that her place is in the kitchen, etc., and in the bedroom. Now, such a woman, she should be the president of Nigeria. It should have been Winnie Mandela who should have been the president of South Africa, Azania, and not sellout Nelson Mandela, who with Tutu and the others sold out, whereby in South Africa, Azania, Europeans still own and control our land. Our people were not fighting, as President Mugabe and ZANU-PF said, to vote. We're fighting for our land. Land, as Malcolm X said, Marcus Garvey said, is the basis of power. He or she who controls land, control everything. You could vote until you're blue in the face. If you do not own and control land, you're not saying anything. You're not voting, we're not talking about to be voting. What we want is the ownership of our land, of our resources. All the riches are based on land. Houses are on land. Where's the gold? Where's the silver? Where's the uranium? The mobile phone here in the Congo. Why do you think they won't leave the Congo? The coltan that is indispensable for these phones. It's in the Congo. pacify the Congo in a constant state of war. Haiti, a couple years ago, President Aristide was overthrown. Why was he overthrown? Because he said that the French owes reparations, and it's true. And he was overthrown by the French and the British. And Haiti is occupied, as we speak, still occupied. Occupied not by the British, nor the French, or the Americans, so-called, but still occupied by them. Why do I say that? They use the UN. That's the cover. UN troops. To keep our people down. President Aristide. Imagine the man is a Haitian. He was overthrown by the Americans, kidnapped, sent out of the country. You know he's back in Haiti now. But he has been told that he cannot participate in the politics of his own country. And yet these hypocritical racist Europeans are talking about what President Assad is doing in Syria. They're always talking about other people's business, but the wickedness that they do, they're not talking about that. They have said that President Aristide, he can only be a private citizen in his own country, Haiti. His party, La Valance, the cleansing, the flood, which would have won and which used to win the elections, has been banned. And yet they talk about they have democracy. But let me tell you people, democracy is a fraud. If you study what is democracy, it's coming from Greece. I'm a student of history. Athens, which is cited as the example, the majority of people in democratic Athens did not have the vote, because women did not have the vote, foreigners did not have the vote, and the majority of and people who were enslaved did not have the vote. Only a few of the men had the vote. That is democracy for you. So democracy is a con, it's a fraud. It is selective dictatorship. That is what it is. So let no one come to you and talk about, oh, we need democracy. What we need is our land. What we need are our resources. And we have to fight to get this. 7, science and technology. Marcus Garvey stressed that the race in philosophy and opinions that masters science and technology is the race that will progress, is the race that will rule. If we do not master science and technology, and remember we are the original inventors of science and technology, the professions, we will be exterminated. They use the World Health Organization, they use the Red Cross and many other things to deep birth, their birth control thing, to depopulate our continent. Why do you think they are doing that? They want to get rid of our people. It's genocide to take over our African motherland. This is not scaremongering or paranoia. This is reality. There were the native people in what is called Canada and the States now. Where are they today, the few that still remain? On reservations. In Jamaica, the Tainos, exterminated. So what I'm saying, the fact that you are native to a place is no guarantee that you will not be exterminated. The only thing that can prevent our extermination is power. As Marcus Garvey said in this, the only remedy for injustice in man is power. And so we must have military power, scientific power, power of every sort. Because as Marcus Garvey said in this truly, man is not moved by prayers and petitions, but man is moved by the power. Woman is moved by the power that forces them to move, whether they want to move or not. And this is why Marcus Garvey said in this too, a race without authority and power is a race without respect. Why do you think we as African people are so disrespected? Our people are shot down in the States, both our brothers and sisters. If we are the United States of Africa government, with one president, as Marcus Garvey said, one army, one navy, and one air force. You think what is happening to us here in Britain, the deaths in custody, the killings of our people in the States, etc. You think those things would happen? They would not happen. Why? Because we would have an African superpower that would deal with any non-African who tried to disrespect and murder our people. There would be consequences. But because they know we do not have the military power, we do not have the scientific power, this is why they take liberties and will continue to take liberties. And this is what I'm saying to you. Let us not despair. But I have to point these things out to show you that our mission in life is very, very serious. It's no joke. We have to work with our people and teach and educate those of our people who are willing to learn, who are willing to come on board and work with us together so that we can progress. And finally, religion, spirituality. This underpins all the seven before. We cannot progress as a people if our religious and spiritual systems do not reflect our racial identity. We cannot be free and strong if we, as Africans, are worshipping and defying the images of non-Africans. As Marcus Garvey said, who is for Muhammad, Arab and so on, let them be for that. Who is for the Jew, Abraham and Isaac, that's good for them. But we must worship the Creator, the God of Africa. Mecca is not our center. Jerusalem is not our center. Africa is our center. As Marcus Garvey said, let Africa be our guiding star, our star of destiny. And I end with Marcus Garvey's words. If you have no confidence in self, you are twice defeated in the race of life. But if you have confidence, you'll have won even before you have started. And I implore you, my people here, do your best. Each of you must have copies of the philosophy and opinions of Marcus Garvey, The Course of African Philosophy by Marcus Garvey, and Race First, Brother Tony Martin's book, the official UNIAM ACL book. And on YouTube, go on YouTube and type in my teacher, Dr. Marcus Garvey Jr. and the Arab Slave Trade. Go on YouTube, Google, type in Dr. Marcus Garvey Jr. and the Arab Slave Trade, where you will hear Marcus Garvey Jr., my teacher, my friend and political leader, give and lecture about our story as Africans and what we have to do. And in it, he shows the wicked, racist, enslaving roles of the European Christians, the Arab Muslims, the Semitic Jews, yes, all three, no exception, and also the traitors, because our enemies always work through the traitors. So our fight is on two fronts. There's the external, those who are the non-Africans we can see. But there are the internal, those who are African just by race, but they are traitors working against us. So our fight is on two fronts and must be conducted simultaneously. It must be conducted simultaneously. So in the words of Marcus Garvey, one creator, one aim, one destiny. Asante sana. Ashe. Ashe.